So this video is not one that was really planned and is more of a product of what I observed in the comment section in my The Last of Us Part 2 analysis. Because of this, this video is probably going to be a lot less structured, more akin to a freeform conversation. Also, while I mentioned Part 2 a bit, you probably won't see any footage from the game, since after I finished my Part 2 analysis, I deleted all my record footage because I am an anal piece of shit who has an anxiety attack as soon as my SS and external hard drives are more than half full. In this video, I will discuss the case for, or perhaps against, one Joel Miller, specifically regarding his final decision in Part 1, where he cut through the fireflies to save Ellie's life, but at the cost of what may have been a vaccine for the cordyceps infection. Even after the game's release back in 2013, a lot of discourse was dedicated to the morality of Joel's final decision. I think most can agree that the finale of Part 1, where Joel saves Ellie from the fireflies, and then lies to her regarding the viability of her vaccine, is one of the most morally questionable decisions in contemporary gaming history. A choice that continues to spark a massive variety of emotions, feelings, questions, and debates throughout the entire fandom. However, as you may have caught on to, I said most can agree. Since while I would personally consider the ending to be quite morally gray, there are others who don't see it that way, with some believing that Joel was completely and utterly morally justified in everything he did in the finale of the game, thus making him the bona fide hero of the tale, whereas some condemn him as a complete and utter selfish villain. Discourse surrounding Joel's final decision in Part 1 received a resurgence upon the release of Part 2, particularly due to the fact that many feel Joel was shown a lack of respect leading up to his death scene. Many were upset that Joel was killed off so early in the game, let alone at all, while others were upset at the contrived nature of how his death plays out, claiming it was a betrayal of his established characterization. And predictably, the debate over the game's treatment of Joel led to quite the furor of online discourse. Detractors and defenders of the game went to work either building a case for why Joel's death was ridiculously out of character, or why those complaining about his death were simply whiny fanboys who were upset that their daddy Joel got clubbed. And, also predictably, this extended into discourse discussing and debating Joel himself, with, again, some claiming him to be an undisputed hero, while others claiming him to be a selfish, evil bastard. This was only amplified by the fact that, while I guess this is debatable, I would argue Part 2 seems to frame Joel's decision in Part 1 as more of a selfish one. I'll touch a bit upon that a little later. In any case, defenders of Joel combed through every single detail of the finale of Part 1 in order to justify Joel's decision, whereas detractors frame Joel in a far less sympathetic light. Cosmonaut Variety Hour, in his really dumbly named review of Part 2, claimed that the ending of Part 1 was actually a complete downer, and that Joel should not be considered a beloved character because he doesn't know what words mean. Just Right claimed that every death that happens after Joel lies to Ellie is his fault, which I find to be an astoundingly what-the-fuck claim. Sadly, like with a lot of media that gets caught up in some part of the quote-unquote culture war, I found a lot of the defenses and demonizations of Joel to be done in a bit of bad faith, with defenders and detractors more interested in holding water for their side, if you will, rather than discussing the morality of Joel's decision in a more nuanced way and, God forbid, considering the other side's frame of reference. This is also present in a lot of discourse regarding The Last Jedi. I think there is a lot of bad faith criticism and a lot of bad faith defense of the film, with many content creators and or media commentators more interested in defending their like-minded peers as opposed to having a more nuanced discussion. I personally think there is a lot wrong with The Last Jedi, but I have seen some absolutely ridiculous nitpicks of the film, as well as some unbelievably absurd arguments in order to defend its completely nutso plot and character turns. Anyway, I digress. Despite the prevalence of discourse regarding the morality of Joel's final decision and how he should be viewed as a person, I was unable to find any sort of in-depth analysis outlining the arguments of both sides, and thus, here I am. In this video, I will lay out both the case for and against the defendant, Joel Miller. Without any further ado, let's get into it. Before we begin, let's give a rundown of the ending of Part 1 to make sure we don't overlook any elements. After arriving in Salt Lake City and failing to cross a treacherous underground tunnel unscathed, Joel and Ellie are both cast into the water. Joel is able to save Ellie and pulls her out of the water, unconscious. He begins to administer CPR when two men, guns drawn, appear behind him. Joel barely reacts to their presence as he is more concerned with making sure Ellie is okay. One of the men approaches Joel and cracks him in the mouth. Joel wakes up presumably several hours later in a hospital and speaks with Marlene, who tells Joel that Ellie is alive. Upon asking to see Ellie, Marlene says Ellie is already being prepped for surgery. She states that the doctors have discovered the nature of Ellie's immunity, and that once they remove her mutated cordyceps, they will be able to engineer a vaccine, but at the cost of Ellie's life. Joel's like, fuck that shit, but he is incapacitated, and Marlene demands he is marched out of the hospital. As Joel is being let out, this dude, aka the worst guard ever, gets overpowered by Joel, who proceeds to make his way to the operating room to save Ellie before it's too late. During his push to the operating room, Joel comes across a number of audio logs, one recorded by the Firefly head surgeon, aka Papa Anderson, and two from Marlene. Don't worry, we will discuss those later on. Joel makes it to the operating room, where he finds Ellie, Jerry, and two medical assistants. Jerry pulls a scalpel on Joel, and Joel proceeds to show him how he feels about that. Joel then races through the hospital, dodging Firefly troops as he makes his way to the elevator. Joel makes his way to the parking garage, but is stopped by Marlene. Marlene tells Joel that Ellie will most likely be killed anyway, so why not allow her to die by saving the world, to which Joel responds it is not for Marlene to decide. Marlene says this is what Ellie would want, and Joel seems to react in a way which communicates that he concurs with this statement, although again, we will discuss this a little later. Marlene approaches, telling Joel Ellie won't feel a thing. Joel proceeds to shoot Marlene and then finishes her off to ensure she doesn't come after them. Ellie wakes up as Joel is driving her from the hospital, and Joel lies to her, saying there were dozens of immune peeps and they all didn't do a damn bit of good. Upon returning to Jackson, Ellie seems to low-key confront Joel about his flimsy-ass story and makes him swear to her he is telling the truth. He swears he is, to which Ellie responds with a simple, okay. So let's backtrack and discuss. Before we get into the more nitty-gritty details, let's discuss the overall moral debate in the finale. The finale is ostensibly set up as a sort of trolley problem, if you will. Am I rehashing my use of this problem from my Watchmen video? Yes. Do I care? No. Anyway, so over here we have the trolley, which is the cordyceps infection, on its way to exterminate the entire human race. Over here we have Marlene, as a stand-in for the Fireflies, who makes a decision to pull the lever, which in this case is killing Ellie. Marlene makes a decision to let Ellie die, but this results in a vaccine being developed and thus the world being saved. Now, let me be clear. Using the trolley problem in this particular case actually has a gaping problem that I will touch upon later. For now, let's just go with the scenario where killing Ellie would 100% lead to a vaccine, which would then lead to the world being saved. So if we go with this scenario, where killing Ellie would without a doubt result in a vaccine being developed, and thus the world being saved, is Joel's decision to rob humanity of said vaccine by saving Ellie morally justified? 100% yes. Those who disagree are often looking at this situation from a utilitarian perspective, the idea that sacrificing one life is worth saving the human race as a whole. The problem is, that isn't how morality works. Just because Ellie's death would lead to the human race being saved does not in any way mean that murdering a single young girl is in any way justified. I guess this may spark discussion about the subjectivity of morality and whatnot, but I think most can agree that despite the good it may lead to, killing Ellie is not in any way morally justified. And here's the thing, I don't even think the Fireflies think they are morally justified. Marlene does say some shit like there is no other choice here, but after hearing her audio logs, we can tell that Marlene is clearly torn up about what she has decided to do. Even Joel calls Marlene out for this, perhaps knowing that she knows she is not morally justified, but is simply telling herself she is in order to live with her decision. Now, while I don't think Marlene and the Fireflies are justified in their decision, it is understandable. As we learn throughout the game, the Fireflies have been fighting and suffering for years, all for a sliver of a chance of saving the human race. 2 decades after the infection has destroyed civilization, and like a miracle, Ellie appears on their doorstep, offering them, for the first time, a truly viable chance at giving sense to all that was lost. Again, while they are not morally justified in their decision, it is understandable given their circumstances. But alas, the Fireflies are in no way in the right here. The situation the game sets up has the Fireflies killing a young girl without her consent. From the moment this was communicated to Joel, he had every right to blast his way through anyone who stood in his way in order to save her. So I could leave the video right there, but let's dive a bit deeper. I am sure some of you watching this video are thinking, well, maybe killing Ellie is not in and of itself morally justified, but Ellie totally would have agreed to sacrificing herself for the chance of creating a vaccine. So that must affect this equation, right? Well, no. Not at all, actually. First off, throughout the entire game, At no point does Ellie ever flat out say, yes, even if it means my death, I would be willing to sacrifice myself for a vaccine. Now, as I mentioned in my part 2 analysis, I would assume that if asked, Ellie would sacrifice herself if it meant giving even a chance at one. But even if this were true, and even if at some point in part 1, we see Ellie straight up tell Joel, yo, you have my permission to end my life if need be, Marlene doesn't know this. Marlene signs off on killing Ellie while Ellie is still unconscious. Sure, Marlene says,
it's what she want.
But she doesn't know that for sure. Again, she is, like me, probably just going off her impression of Ellie and may even be trying to convince herself that Ellie would have said yes to quell her own guilt. But regardless of any of this, Marlene and the Fireflies did not get Ellie's consent to kill her to create the vaccine. At no point before the finale of the game is this even brought up as a potential outcome. Again, based on my take of Ellie, despite the fact that Ellie didn't expect to die upon arriving in Salt Lake City, I think she would be willing to. But again, this doesn't matter. Marlene and the Fireflies didn't get the go-ahead from her. What would happen if Ellie woke up and after Marlene tells her she would need to bite it to make the vaccine, Ellie was like, fuck that noise. I would actually argue this is in part why Marlene and the Fireflies don't wait for Ellie to wake up. Because if they do, and she refuses to sacrifice herself, well, fuck. Would they be like, okay? Or just say fuck it and straight up murder Ellie? At first I thought it was rather silly that the Fireflies don't wake Ellie up, but in retrospect, it makes sense. The Fireflies know what they are doing is not morally right, and they know that if Ellie says no, they may not be able to live with themselves if they then decide to move forward with murdering an innocent girl. So they sort of have to tell themselves that this is what she would have wanted, even if they don't really believe it themselves. This, mind you, is completely ignoring the fact that even if Ellie did straight up tell Joel, or hell, even Marlene and the Fireflies, that yeah, I would be down to die for the cause, since Ellie is only 14, can she be said to be old enough to make an informed decision here? Mind you, this is even further muddied by the fact that the Fireflies would probably give Ellie the impression they have a far greater chance of creating a vaccine than they probably do, most likely downplaying the chance they may fail. Once again, I digress. I would argue that Joel, from the get-go, and factoring in that the Fireflies went ahead without Ellie's consent, even if we assume she totally would have given said consent, would be wholly morally justified in doing what he did. In addition to this, we have some more factors to consider in support of the case for Joel. Remember how I mentioned earlier that the trolley problem wasn't really an appropriate thought experiment to apply to the ending of part 1? Well, there is a reason the trolley problem only exists as a hypothetical thought experiment, because the parameters of the trolley problem require a particular element that cannot exist in reality, and that element is certainty. In the scenario I presented earlier to demonstrate Marlene and the Fireflies' choice to kill Ellie in order to make a vaccine, I added in the element of certainty for both outcomes. By that I mean, I presume that if Ellie was killed, it would 100% lead to a vaccine, and if she was not killed, that it would 100% lead to the complete and utter destruction of the human race. The problem is, that just isn't how reality works. There will always be an element of what if, or uncertainty, whenever you are making any sort of moral decision similar to that of the trolley problem. One of the most difficult things about these sort of decisions made in real life, especially ones where the stakes are so high, is that there are so many other factors influencing the outcomes that there is no sure way to 100% guarantee a certain outcome will come about. So what does this have to do with The Last of Us? Well, let's start off with the idea that if the Fireflies do not kill Ellie and make a vaccine, that eventually humanity will die off. Well, this is sort of questionable. When we pick up 20 years after the infection outbreak, we learn that roughly 60% of the world's population was killed due to the spread of the virus. Per the wiki, this death toll was achieved several months after the infection. Okay, so let me get this straight. After the outbreak, 60% of the world's population was decimated within a matter of months. So let's just say that article was from 12 months, to be generous, after the outbreak. And thus, that would mean, at this rate, the entire human population would be wiped out in the span of another 8 months. Now let's be charitable and say, well, if the world really bunkered down and took extreme measures to control the infection, and given the fact that the thinning of the population would lead to the spread of the infection slowing down, that this may begin to slow the extinction of humanity. Okay, but you would still think that the human race would only be able to hang on for, say, another 4 to 5 years tops before the infection, famine, other illnesses, etc., wiped them out completely. And yet 20 years later, when we catch up with Joel, I mean, it's not like the human race is doing well per se, but they're still kicking. During the course of the game, we don't really get an idea of what percentage of the world's population is still alive. It's probably hella low, granted, but still, it's never really talked about. And we don't really know how fast the remaining population is dying off. Has it leveled off? Are societies beginning to rebuild to some extent? The point I am making is that even if a vaccine was never made for the infection, there is always the possibility that the human race would still, at least to some extent, prosper and thrive. There are masks, quarantine zones, etc. Boars are really easy to see, so it's not like they are all that difficult to avoid. Would future humans eventually develop an immunity for the infection? Maybe Ellie's immunity is simply a genetic anomaly that may present itself in more children as the years go on, that can then be passed on through subsequent generations. The grand point I am making is that there really doesn't seem to be any evidence that, if something is not done, that the remaining human population will completely die off. Hell, in part 2, after Joel makes his decision to save Ellie, we see both the Jackson settlement, the WLF community, and the Seraphite camp all doing pretty well in terms of surviving and rebuilding. Who is to say that in 50 or 100 years, the human race wouldn't be able to fully adapt to living in their new world? I guess if it was said that the infection was spreading and would eventually encase the globe, that would be one thing, but to my knowledge, that isn't the case. Well, yeah, maybe humanity would be able to manage the infection, but what about the infected? Well, it's made pretty clear in parts 1 and 2 that the infected are literally the least dangerous parts of this new world, as they are pretty predictable and easy to manipulate. As we see in part 2, a system of daily patrols would probably be sufficient enough to take care of most of the infected in a given area. Also, you could just live on islands, granted there are no spores. Yeah, but people would still turn. Okay, but so what? Over time, the infection rate would become lower and lower due to the thinning of the population, and the remaining humans would eventually be able to handle the infected in a more efficient way. Also consider that even though the infected seem to be the least dangerous aspect of this new world, as opposed to food shortages, other illnesses, and hunters and raiders, them actually infecting you is, like, their least dangerous characteristic. As we see in both games, runners, clickers, and bloaters don't just want to take a nibble on your ear. They more often than not will beat you to death, rip your jugular out, or tear your jaw apart. I'm just laughing to myself thinking of some poor dude getting beaten to death by a runner and he just yells out to his homies, "It's okay guys, I'm immune." Also consider, as I mentioned, even if a vaccine were made and widely administered, that still wouldn't solve the problems of massive resource shortages, food, antibiotics, medical care, etc. Also, civil conflict is rampant in this new world, and it's not like everyone being immune would do anything to quell these tensions. In part 2, the conflict between the Seraphites and the WLF seems to have nothing to do with the infected, and both of their communities seem completely equipped and experienced enough to deal with the infected in their respective areas. This goes back to just how silly Just Right's assertion was that every death that happens after Joel makes his choice is on his shoulders. I'm pretty sure the infected themselves didn't lead to the Seraphites cutting people's innards out. Also, engineering a vaccine takes a hella long time, my dude, even under regular, non-post-apocalyptic standards. Even if Joel didn't save Ellie and a vaccine was made, it probably wouldn't be ready for distribution for a long time, and thus the Seraphites and WLF would have probably ended up decimating each other before they even knew about it. However, all of what I just brought up assumes that the vaccine would be widely administered to every single person left on Earth. How? Even if they had the technology, resources, and expertise to make enough of the vaccine to administer to the remaining population, which in and of itself is a massive long shot, how would they go about spreading the word about the vaccine? How would they handle the massive influx of people entering certain areas to get their hands on it? How would they be able to set up a system for who gets immunized first? I am sure it would take a long-ass time to engineer the vaccine in a large enough quantity, let alone at all. I mean, they could just wait until they had enough for the whole world, but that could take decades. Do enough resources even remain to make this possible? This is also assuming that the Fireflies would be able to, I guess, make peace with Fedra? Given their guerrilla army-like structure, it's not like the Fireflies would be able to make and administer the vaccine on their own in a sufficient enough quantity. Maybe they would go to Fedra and ask them to help, but what is to stop Fedra from saying, "Hey, thanks," and then telling them to fuck off? They are classified as terrorists by Fedra after all, right? And who is to say Fedra would freely administer the vaccine rather than using it to keep their authoritarian-like hold over the remaining population? And even if Fedra did want to administer the vaccine to everyone, who is to say they would be competent enough to do so and wouldn't fuck it up royally? Not that we have any contemporary examples of such a thing happening. However, every single point I just brought up is completely dependent on the idea that the Fireflies would in fact be able to make a vaccine by using Ellie's fungal mutation, even though the odds of them doing so would be pretty null. Let's ignore the actual competence of the Fireflies for now, we'll get to that later, and just assume they have the most brilliant of scientists, such as the world-renowned Gerry Anderson, who we can totally trust to make a vaccine, even though the dude can't hold his own in a knife fight for shit. Well, what are the actual odds of them being able to do so, even if they had the best of the best trying? Remember back when I mentioned that tape recorder we find from the head surgeon? Well, let's actually take a look at what he says in the recording. So between the medical mumbo-jumbo, there are a couple of questionable lines that cast doubt, not necessarily on the competence of the Fireflies, again, we'll get to that later, but rather the viability of them making a vaccine with Ellie's mutation. One of the lines is,
"The girl's infection is like nothing I've ever seen. The cause of her immunity is uncertain. As we've seen in all past cases."
Woo, lad! Pump the brakes. All past cases? As in, were there other people who were immune? I mean, maybe he is talking about something else, but from this line, it sounds like they had other people who were at least suspected to be immune, and they all ended up not being viable. The dude even says he has never seen anything like this before, so how would he know for sure that Ellie's immunity is something that could be replicated and administered to others? Now, this line is a little odd, and maybe when he says past cases, he is talking about just regular old infected they have experimented on, but that makes it even worse. The docs literally have no experience with immunity to the infection, and they are pretty much going in blind. And then there is this line on the same recording.
"We must find a way to replicate this state under laboratory conditions."
Whoa, ease up there, partner. Based on this line, this makes it seem like Mr. Anderson doesn't even know the exact nature of Ellie's immunity, nor does it make it seem like he has any idea as to how he could replicate it. So just to lay this out, Gerry could cut Ellie's head open, fuck around with her brain for a few weeks, but ultimately come to the conclusion that, yeah, sorry, we have no idea why she is immune or how to replicate this. Sorry, pack it up, y'all. This actually makes Marlene's line to Joel kind of misleading when she tells him straight up they can make a vaccine. Well, no, even Gerry was like, well, maybe, hopefully, but IDK. I don't necessarily think this is Marlene lying to Joel straight up, but rather just her being desperately optimistic. That is something I'm going to go into a bit more in the next section. So let me recap for a hot second. There is no guarantee that cutting Ellie's head open would lead to the doctors learning the nature of her immunity. There is no way to be sure, even if they did, that they would be able to engineer a vaccine. Even if they did manage to engineer a vaccine, administering it on a massive scale is an absolute theoretical logistic clusterfuck. And even if they were able to administer the vaccine on a massive scale, immunizing literally every single person who remains, that would still not take care of the far more pressing dangers to the remaining human population, such as lack of resources, their fellow man, and the deadly infected who still remain. And even if the vaccine did somehow fix all of these problems, it may have only slightly sped up the already impending resurgence of the human race. But even considering all of this incredibly optimistic hypothetical thinking, this still does not morally justify killing a single young girl, even if Marlene somehow telepathically knew that it was in fact what Ellie would have wanted. So that was pretty much everything. Well, oh yeah, except even if you say fuck Ellie's autonomy, assume the vaccine would cure all the other world's problems I mentioned, and assume that the nature of Ellie's immunity would be able to be understood, replicated, and widely administered, there is also the fact that the Fireflies are absolute chuckle fucks. This was first brought up, at least for me, in Joseph Anderson's review of The Last of Us back in 2016, where he lays out the numerous signs pointing to the incompetence of the Fireflies as an organization. I will link the video in the description along with a timestamp of where he discusses this, but let me give a quick little rundown. The Fireflies are losing ground all over the nation. They carry out full-on terrorist attacks against Fedra. When Ellie and Joel arrive at the college and find the Firefly test lab, not only do we find evidence that all of their experiments have failed miserably, but this fucking dude got himself bit by one of the test monkeys. When Joel and Ellie arrive in Salt Lake City, and after Ellie almost drowns and Joel tries to resuscitate her, the guards, for some reason, knock Joel out immediately instead of being like, Hey, do you think this may be the smuggler and little girl Marlene mentioned was the last hope for humanity? It's best not to assume. When Joel wakes up after what has been like maybe several hours at most, Marlene tells him they are already getting Ellie ready for surgery. There is no possible way they could have possibly done hardly any of the necessary preemptive testing that would be standard for any medical procedure, especially one of this magnitude and one this rare and vital. Hell, when I got my appendix out, I am pretty sure I was laying on my ass for like 2 hours while the docs got all their shit ready and whatnot. How could the doctors possibly know that Ellie would need to die in order to make a vaccine? What if they could use a blood sample? How about a biopsy? By the way Marlene puts it, it sounds like Jerry took one look at Ellie's brain scan and then was like, yep, put that little bitch under the knife and scoop the whole brain out of there. Again, consider he says this is literally like nothing they have ever seen before and may be their literal only shot in history to get this right. And within a few hours of testing, they are ready to kill her? What if the nature of her immunity is only able to be determined while she is still alive and kicking? Wouldn't you make sure every single test and procedure was run in order to ensure that you were making the right call? A process that would take at the very least several days, if I am being super generous, upwards of weeks if I am being super realistic. Aside from all that, let's just look at how stupid Marlene and the Fireflies are in the final segment of the game. Marlene and the Fireflies, for whatever reason, don't just kill Joel before he wakes up in the hospital, or simply tell Joel Ellie is already dead. It seems based on Marlene's tape recorder that they were totally just using Joel since he was just some smuggler, so why leave him alive and not just kill him right where the two guards found him near the entrance of the tunnel? Well, Marlene says that they told her to kill him, but she said no because he of all people would understand the weight of her decision. I assume this means that Marlene is assuming Joel has grown to care for Ellie during their time together, but why? From her impression of Joel back in Boston, he was a pretty pessimistic and ruthless dude, so why would she presume he actually gave a crap about Ellie and wasn't just using her as a bargaining chip for those guns that are mentioned as his initial primary motivation for transporting Ellie that are completely forgotten about within a few hours into the game? When Joel wakes up, Marlene is all like, you don't have to worry about her anymore. Does this mean that she isn't aware of the bond they have formed for one another? And even if Marlene doesn't want to kill Joel, how does she know the guard won't march Joel out in the parking lot and cap his ass just to be safe? And then there is the Firefly guard, who is laughably inept, as we have already gone over. Once Joel makes his way through the hospital and saves Ellie, there is also the fact that as Joel makes it to the elevator, the Firefly troops fucking open fire on them, even though he is holding the literal only hope for humanity, the one thing they have all been fighting for decades. And then in the parking garage, Marlene, who came down here alone, for some reason, to confront the dude who literally just slaughtered his way through half a squadron, offers Joel the chance to walk and tries to appeal to his sympathetic side. Dude, he literally just killed Lord knows how many people to save Ellie. I don't think trying to reason with him is going to fly at this moment. Marlene, you had the drop on him. Just cap his ass and bring Ellie back upstairs. Also, part 2 actually retcons this entire segment to oblivion for 2 reasons. One, Marlene said she left Joel alive as he could be the one person who would understand the weight of the decision to kill Ellie, even though Jerry has a daughter who is Ellie's age and clearly knows the weight of what he is deciding to go forward with. And two, when Marlene is like, there is still a chance here, well, no, because as part 2 lays out, after Jerry gets shanked, there is literally no hope for making a vaccine, so even if Joel did change his mind and dropped Ellie like a sack of potatoes, they would still be out their only surgeon. Also, and this is just a little nitpick, not really that big of a deal, but here's an article from 2014, several months after the outbreak in the game, stating that there are currently no approved vaccines for any and all fungal infections. Look, I know there was a whole lot of nitpicking up in here, but again, I am trying to make the best possible case for Joel. In any case, I would argue that despite literally 95% of what I have brought up thus far, Joel's decision in and of itself is pretty damn morally justified. Add in the fact that Joel really didn't have any time to process any of this, as Marlene told him almost immediately upon waking up that Ellie was already being prepped for surgery, and well, yeah, what the hell did you expect him to do? But anyway, yeah, I'd say from a moral standpoint, Joel's justification for doing what he did is completely and utterly sound. So, is that the end of the video? Well, no, it isn't just about the moral justification of Joel's actions, but who Joel is as a person. I think the discourse has, like a lot of discourse tends to do, fractured a bit where you have two sides who are arguing over completely different things. That was pretty vague, so allow me to go more into detail in our next section. So as I said, one of the most annoying things about online discourse, especially surrounding issues that have become very topical, and in some cases vitriolic, is that after wading through a lot of the arguments and counterarguments, you start to realize that the two sides are arguing and bickering while going off completely different base frames of reference. In the case of Joel Miller, those who defend Joel's decision usually do so, as I did in the previous section, on a moral justification basis, whereas those who condemn Joel do so by breaking down Joel as a person, as an individual. Except, again, these really aren't the same thing. Someone can do something immoral, but that doesn't necessarily mean, depending on the context, they are a bad person. And then there is the flip side. Just because someone does something that can be said to be morally justified doesn't necessarily mean they did so with the most righteous intentions in mind. And that brings us to Joel. So those who condemn Joel, again, often do so, not by bringing up the moral justification of the decision, which I'd say, again, is pretty cut and dry, but rather his motivation for making said decision. So if we take a look at almost all of the details I presented in the previous section, the viability of creating and administering a vaccine, whether or not a vaccine would even be all that necessary in ensuring the survival of the human race, and the actual moral justification of killing Ellie without her consent, while all of these things do seem to make Joel's decision a lot more palatable, the point is, Joel probably wasn't aware, didn't consider, or didn't give two flying fucks about any of that shit. I really don't think Joel, as a contractor turned smuggler, has any idea of the improbability of a vaccine being discovered, engineered, and administered to the remaining population. Or even if he has mulled over the fact, again, it doesn't seem like he factored this in at all. To plagiarize my own point from my part 2 analysis, it's not as if Joel, in the, what, couple minutes between waking up and being told that Ellie was probably, for all he knew, minutes away from being cut open, and his decision to save her, did a statistical analysis of all the logistical and scientific factors I have already brought up. I would argue that almost everything I brought up in the previous section was simply not a factor in Joel's decision making. He simply wanted to save Ellie, consequences be damned. In my part 2 analysis, I also brought up the idea that Joel really didn't care either way about the vaccine, even if it were a 100% guarantee by killing Ellie. In the scene where Joel speaks with Ellie on the roof, Joel seemingly tries to urge Ellie to turn around and head back to Jackson. Remember, this is before Joel has any idea or reason to suspect that making a vaccine will lead to Ellie dying. I think the idea of this scene was to show that Joel just didn't really care about a vaccine either way. Whether this was because he didn't believe the human race had the capability of being, or deserved to be redeemed, or he was only concerned about himself and those he considered part of his tribe, if you will, I can't say. But either way, it is made clear that all of the stuff I mentioned in the first section regarding the viability of the vaccine, or whether or not the Fireflies were being so incompetent and risked fucking up humanity's only shot for a vaccine, literally had no impact on Joel's decision making at the moment. But then again, as I brought up, there really wasn't a decision to be made. Joel had to make this decision in the span of about a few minutes. He didn't really have time to process all the other factors and whatnot. He was told Ellie was minutes from death. His decision to go after her is almost more of an instinctual animal-like drive to save the one he cares for most, something that I think anyone can sympathize and empathize with. However, the true decision comes in the parking garage when Marlene confronts Joel. After Marlene pulls a gun on Joel and tries to convince him to walk away, Joel says that Ellie's death isn't for Marlene to decide. While he is completely correct in saying this, note that, again, it's about whether or not this has anything to do with his motivation. Do I think Ellie's bodily autonomy has anything to do with Joel's decision to save her? Probably not. Again, from a moral justification standpoint, it's a solid line of defense, but we are discussing Joel's motivation. If Joel's motivation was to honor Ellie's autonomy, when Marlene follows up with,
"It's what she'd want,"
Joel probably would have been like, "Well, you may be right, but you didn't wake her ass up and get her sign off, you stupid bitch. So, guess what?" But instead, Joel does this.
"It's what she'd want."
And this is an interesting little beat right here, so let's talk it over. Now, as I mentioned before, while Ellie at no point during the length of the game explicitly states that she would be willing to die for a shot of vaccine, based on her characterization, I myself, and I think most would presume, that if given the option, Ellie would be willing to give her own life for a chance at a vaccine. Many have mentioned that she did make plans with Joel after they make it to the Fireflies, which means she was not expecting to die. But this is rather irrelevant. No one, not even the Fireflies, knew Ellie would need to die to make a vaccine until she got there. The question isn't was Ellie expecting to die, it's would she be willing to do so if that's what it would have taken. Again, without saying with absolute certainty, I would argue she probably would. Marlene says this is what Ellie would want, but again, take this with a grain of salt. Since Marlene probably wants to believe this is what Ellie would want, in order to make the fact that she gave the go-ahead to kill her an easier pill to swallow. But then there is Joel's reaction, and here is where things get a bit tricky. Joel has traveled with Ellie for the past year and understands who she is as a person and what drives her. Unlike Joel, who has given up on humanity and is inherently self-interested, Ellie still has her optimism about the world despite all she has been through, and her extreme empathy for even those she comes to know for a very short time is blatantly evident. And thus, when Marlene tells Joel that this is what Ellie would want and he knows it, regardless of how disingenuous Marlene is being, it does seem that the game is communicating to the player that Joel knows that Ellie would indeed give up her life for a chance at a vaccine. So, yeah, this is sort of the writers cheating a bit, if you will. In Joseph Anderson's review of The Last of Us, he brought up the fact that the Fireflies are, just going off of what we learn about them in the narrative, drawn as complete buffoons. He went on to propose two options. One, Naughty Dog purposely left these aspects about the Fireflies in the game for the player to notice, thus resulting in Joel's decision being that of a savior rescuing Ellie from a bunch of self-aggrandizing fraudsters. This is the option that Joseph personally went with. Or two, Naughty Dog wanted the player to sort of forget about all that noise, and the way the finale is structured, along with the Fireflies finding Ellie unconscious and the supposed testing they did coming back so quickly, was simply a way to set up the ending they wanted and to frame Joel's decision in the end as one that was inherently selfish. In an interview in regard to the ending of part 1, writer Neil Druckmann stated, "Then we come to that ending, and that lie, and that okay, and what does that okay mean? It's definitely not a complacent, yeah, I'll go along with you. In fact, it's the opposite. It's Ellie waking up for the first time, waking up and realizing she can't rely on him anymore. While she loves him for what he's done for her, she hates him for robbing her of that choice." Take note of the phrase, robbed her of that choice. Now, when put in the context of everything I just went over, this is a ridiculous thing to say. Joel didn't rob her of shit. The Fireflies did when they decided to go forward with cutting her skull open when she was still unconscious. So why does Neil frame this as Joel robbing Ellie of her choice? And this is where I disagree with Joseph Anderson's take. I think the game, in a way, wanted us to buy into the potential for the vaccine a bit more than perhaps the actual contextual evidence found in the game itself warrants. They wanted to frame Joel's decision in the end as an inherently selfish one. Again, while Joel does say,
"It ain't for you to decide."
When Marlene says this is what Ellie would want, you would think Joel would say, again, something along the lines of, "Bitch, you don't know." But instead, the writers have him give this look, which is basically him being like, "Yeah, you're probably right." Again, I think this was done in an effort to frame Joel saving Ellie, which, as I have demonstrated on paper, was probably the most moral thing to do in this specific situation from every angle, as more of a betrayal, as him going against Ellie's wishes, even though these wishes were never explicitly expressed in the text. Sure, there is the scene where Ellie tells him it can't all be for nothing, but the question is, would Ellie still say yes if she looked at the situation from a completely rational perspective, as I laid out in the previous section of this video? But then again, Ellie probably wouldn't make the most rational decision anyway. She is a young girl who has seen every single person she has loved and cared for succumb to the one thing she is miraculously immune to, leaving her with a massive amount of trauma and perpetual survivor's guilt. Even if she did consider everything I have presented in this video about the viability of the vaccine or the sketchiness of the Fireflies, I still think Ellie would probably give her life if only for a sliver of a chance at making a vaccine. And this goes along with the themes of the game. As I detailed in my part 2 analysis, characters like Tess, Ellie, and Marlene, who all seemingly believe that a vaccine will lead to a new world, may not be looking at the situation from an entirely rational perspective. They are, as Joel puts it, finding something to fight for. Whether or not deep down they believe a vaccine will work is irrelevant. They need to believe, to give sense to all the horror they have endured, to keep them moving forward. And this is in part why I think the ending of the game still works, even if you think the Fireflies had an abysmal chance at making a vaccine. Whether or not the vaccine would save the world or really have any effect whatsoever, it's about finding hope, finding a light in the darkness. When faced with Armageddon, will humans say to hell with rationality and try to latch on to any hope they can, such as Ellie, Tess, Henry, and Marlene do? Or will they allow the despair to turn them into jaded individuals who only trudge on via some animalistic instinct to survive, like Bill, David, and of course, Joel? The dichotomy between Ellie and Joel is not one as simple as good and evil or optimism and pessimism. It's believing there must be something out there that will bring sense to this entire clusterfuck and becoming a person who will overcome the despair of this new world or resign to the fact that no such hope or answer exists and allowing yourself to become a product of it. How ironic that one of Joel's final lines to Ellie to keep finding something to fight for is contradicted by his decision to prevent her from doing just that. So, all in all, this is where the biggest disconnect between those who angelify and demonize Joel rears its head. Not just that I feel those who defend Joel do so by discussing the moral justification of his actions, whereas those who condemn him do so by mainly focusing on his underlying motivations, regardless of whether or not it was morally justified, but also in that it seems that those who condemn Joel seem to be more agreeable and receptive to what the writers were trying to insist. I don't mean that in a negative or condescending way. It is clear to me, again, to disagree with Joseph Anderson's take, the writers wanted the player to buy into both the idea that the viability of the vaccine was much higher than I would argue it plausibly is. Keep in mind that there were currently no methods of making a vaccine for fungal infections during development of the game, and I don't even think now, which I would argue shows the writers were sort of playing fast and loose with hardcore rationality when writing the story. But also, the idea that Ellie, if given the choice, would 100% say yes to giving up her life, even if it meant there was only a sliver of a chance that a vaccine could be made. And if you buy into these two things, this is where we see the more selfish and self-serving Joel. As I said, it's not probable that Joel did an entire rundown of the difficulties of making a vaccine. And while he says, it ain't for you to decide, his reaction to Marlene telling him this is what Ellie would want seems to imply that he does in fact believe that this is in fact what Ellie would want. With that in mind, even if you consider Joel's initial push to save Ellie as an almost animalistic instinct, or perhaps even a fight-or-flight response due to the trauma he most likely carries from Sarah's death, Joel seems to realize what he has done while in the parking garage with Marlene, and has a moment to consider the weight of his actions. But he still decides to take out Marlene and save Ellie. So with all of that in mind, what is Joel's motivation here? Well, it's pretty simple. Despite knowing that this is what Ellie wants, Joel decides he doesn't want, or rather can't bear, to lose her, and thus he decides to kill Marlene and lie to Ellie. Which, again, when buying into what I would argue the writers want the player to buy into, is an inherently selfish decision. In this moment, Joel isn't doing this because he respects Ellie's bodily autonomy. He isn't doing this because he is considering the improbability of a vaccine having all that much of an effect on the world. He isn't doing this because he is consciously considering how sketchy as fuck the Fireflies as an organization are. He simply doesn't want to lose Ellie. This is why Neil Druckmann frames Joel's final decision to save Ellie as quote-unquote robbing her of that choice. Because from Neil's perspective, based on Ellie's characterization, Ellie has already committed to giving whatever it takes to make a vaccine, including her own life. And I would argue this is sort of supported by the fact that Joel lies to Ellie in the final scene of the game. Consider if everything I brought up in the previous section, Joel had factored into his decision making. If that was the case, then why lie to Ellie? Ellie would be like, swear to me you are telling the truth about the Fireflies, and Joel would be like, look, yeah, I lied, but the Fireflies were sus as fuck. They didn't even wait for you to wake up and ask what you wanted. I'm no medical expert, but it seems like a few hours is way too soon to start cutting mini bitches open and scooping out their brain, and you never explicitly said you'd want to die, so how the fuck would I know that is for sure what you wanted? As many have pointed out, if Joel had been completely honest with Ellie and laid everything out, well, I am sure she would be upset at him, but I'd argue that, especially over time, Ellie may at least understand that all things considered, he probably made the right call. So, why did he lie? Well, perhaps Joel did so because, despite the fact he believes his actions were completely morally justified, if he told her the truth, she would still feel a sense of survivor's guilt, and he wanted to spare her that. Which is sort of kind of negated by the fact that she is still instilled with that burden regardless, and his lie in some way only makes it worse. Instead of being like, look, your immunity is still really special, but the Fireflies weren't it, Chief. He's like, yeah, no, your immunity means nothing, and everything your friends died for was for nothing. Sorry, not sorry. I honestly think a more likely explanation is that Joel lied to her because he, at least on some level, knew his decision was made out of some self-serving desire to keep her close to him. He knew she would have wanted to give her life and deliberately decided to take that away from her. Again, even if Joel did believe he was completely morally justified in doing what he did, the fact that he lies to her, at least to me, shows that he on some level knows that any explanation he could come up with does not change the fact that he saved her because he didn't want to lose her. This is actually even supported in part 2. When Joel ends up admitting to Ellie the truth about what happened that day, he doesn't try to justify himself or explain the absolute logistical clusterfuck that is engineering and administering a vaccine in the middle of a worldwide apocalypse. As he states in the final scene of the game, he of course does not regret his decision or believe he was in the wrong in any way, but he does know that, to some extent, he did rob her of her chance to give sense to all those she loves that were lost, regardless of how slim that chance actually was. And thus, if you go simply by Joel's apparent motivations, based on the information presented in the text of the game, him deciding to save Ellie, despite knowing this was in fact what she would have wanted, I can see how many may consider Joel to be a selfish individual as he deliberately decided to rob Ellie of her purpose in order to retain his own. Whew, that was a lot. So, let me finish up with a conclusion containing a bit of a too long didn't watch summary, as well as my own thoughts on Joel as a character. For those of you who consider Joel to be a selfish or evil character and condemn his actions at the end of part 1, I urge you to consider the more rational aspects of the situation that I detailed in the first section of this video, namely the improbability that a vaccine, even if it were somehow miraculously developed by a sketchy-ass group of ragtags like the Fireflies, would do much of anything at all to help the situation the human race finds itself in terms of prolonging their existence, and the fact that despite the fact you may think Ellie would totally be down to sacrifice herself, the Fireflies had no way of knowing that for sure and gave the go-ahead to kill a young girl without her consent. For those of you who defend Joel and believe he did absolutely nothing wrong in the conclusion of part 1, I would suggest, rather than looking at the situation from a more moral justification standpoint, try and view Joel based on his displayed motivations for and the cost of his decisions, namely saving Ellie because he didn't want to lose her, despite robbing her of a chance to give sense to the deaths of all of those she has loved and lost. Again, this video really wasn't about making a solid determination either way, but merely to elaborate and explain the viewpoints of both sides of the aisle, and where each side is coming from, something that will hopefully result in these discussions not ending up as echo chamber-like battles against a raging army of straw men. As for my own personal take on Joel as a character, while I would wholeheartedly agree that Joel's actions in the finale of part 1 are totally morally justifiable, as for how I judge him as a person, again, I feel I have to judge Joel based on what information he has at the time of making a particular decision, as well as his state of mind in doing so. I can in no way blame or judge him for the initial push to save Ellie, as given Joel's character, I feel this is more of an instinctive drive, especially given the trauma he still holds over the death of Sarah. But when Marlene tells Joel that he knows this is what Ellie would want, and his expression seems to communicate that he knows, or at least thinks this is in fact what she would want, this is the moment where Joel makes his fateful decision. Regardless of Ellie's autonomy, regardless of the probability of a vaccine, or whether or not it would do any good, even if they were able to make one, regardless of how he feels about the Fireflies, Joel knows the potential cost of doing what he is about to do. He knows it will result in any chance, no matter how slim, of a vaccine being developed and thus condemning the human race to whatever their fate may be, and that it will result in Ellie living her life knowing she will never be able to use her immunity to give sense to all the lives that were lost along the way, and he does it anyway. Now, while it may sound like I consider Joel's decision in the finale to be one of selfishness, at the same time, I have trouble drawing that line, as I feel by nature of being human, all of our decisions can, to some extent, be both selfless and selfish in varying degrees simultaneously. While I do feel that Ellie probably would have wanted to sacrifice her life for a chance at a vaccine, after growing to care for Ellie over the course of the game, just like Joel did, I can't say that, despite its implications, I wasn't initially glad and relieved to know she was not killed. There was a part of me that wanted Ellie to live a full life and be loved and be happy. And despite the fact that, yes, Joel's decision was to some extent made for selfish reasons, I honestly think wanting to give Ellie a good life was mixed in there as well. Hell, look at Ellie's character motivations to see what I'm talking about. Yes, Ellie was selfless in the sense that she fought so damn hard to make it to the Fireflies to make a vaccine, to hopefully prevent the deaths of others in the future, but is her drive to do so also in some way self-serving, as a way to relieve herself from the incredible survivor's guilt she lives with? What I love so much about part 1, as I detail in my part 2 analysis, was, while I felt part 2 seemed to try and set a moral baseline that the player's perception of the characters was projected onto, part 1 was a rare piece of more mainstream storytelling, especially in terms of video game writing, that didn't seem to concern itself with worrying about whether or not the characters were good or bad, or moral or immoral. Rather, it made the characters as humanly possible, imbuing them with a level of complexity that is cheapened by trying to separate them into rigid categories. Regardless of your view of Joel, his decision in the end being heroic or horrific, selfless or selfish, but it was, in the end, human, which is why, love him, hate him, or feel somewhere in between about him, he is one of the greatest characters period in recent gaming history. I hope this video has helped give some understanding to the warring sides of this topic of discourse, and hopefully it will result in discussions from now on being less disconnected and all over the place. If I myself failed to mention any aspects of either argument, feel free to discuss in the comments. And last but not least, I hope this video also promotes nuanced and reasonable discussion, where everyone is open to the new ideas and viewpoints, and the discourse is centered around a general atmosphere of charitability and positivity. Also, be sure to check out my analysis of part 2 where I rip it a new asshole. Don't forget to subscribe to the channel, consider supporting me on Patreon, and I'll see you next time.